you guys doing? I'm Joseph Smith with the Revolutionary Connection, and I ask that you subscribe to it. This Revolutionary Connection is on YouTube, and I also have a page, group page on Facebook, and that group is called Road to Armageddon. I ask that you subscribe to those. Today I'll be talking to you about the gospel versus the word of God. It seems like in today's time we've had a whole lot of confusion. We have in our country, in America, where we're at, we have a president that's a racist, that's dividing our nation. But beyond all of that, it seems like what is going on in our world is a lack of God. It's a lack of compassion for men and it's for your neighbor, you know, really, because you look at the people, whether you be white or black, when you look, these are your neighbors, these are the people you've been dealing with for years. And all of a sudden you have a guy come along, and I guess some of you would have to say some of this has been hitting into people. And now all of a sudden there's a great racial divide. The church seems to be completely out of whack and out of touch with the people. And I want to start off with the Bible, because I can tell you a lot of opinions, and that seems to be the problem in the world. The Bible talks about information shall increase. And you see it, information increasing, but you don't see the fact that the good from the bad. Read out what's true and what is false. And so we're living in this era, and it's an era where evil's being praised and good's being called bad. If you look at the world we live in now, if you say something against homosexuality, you're considered to be backwards and evil. But let's get on into these scriptures, because that's why I'm here. I'm here to give you a light when there seems to be no light, you know, at this particular time. And I'm going to start in Amos 8. And it says, behold, Amos 8, the chapter of Amos 8, and verse 11. It says, behold, the day cometh, says the Lord, that I will send a famine in the land. Not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. Notice he said, a hearing the words of the Lord. A lot of people got to understand sometimes we're dealing with metaphor. Hearing, I can speak to you in French. You heard me, but you didn't understand me. So let's look at the word as hearing the word of the Lord. In other words, people with understanding of the word of God. It is a very big difference between an interpretation and a revelation. A revelation has, you're having a clear understanding of the word of God. An interpretation is me passing my opinion. Okay, and it says in verse 12, it says, and they shall wander from sea to sea, from the north even to the east, and they shall run to and fro to seek the word of the Lord. They're looking for it. They want to hear the word of God, and shall not find it. In that day shall the fair virgins and young men faint for thirst, for that hunger of the word of God. And then we're going on to what is 1 Samuel chapter 3. Okay, and I'm going to start at verse 1. And the children of Samuel ministered unto the Lord before Eli. And the word of the Lord, was precious in those days. There were no open vision like we're living in today. There's no people running around, but very few with understanding of the word of God. There is no open vision. So just like now, we have all these churches, but nobody seems to have a sense of direction, a sense of purpose. They don't even understand what is the gospel. You know, I put the thing up, the gospel, today's gospel versus the word of God. You know, what is the day? The day gospel is foreign from the word of God. It's not the same thing that Jesus was teaching. Okay? In verse 2 said, it came to pass at that time when Eli was laid down in his place, and his eyes began to wax dim, that he could not see. In the air, the lamp of the Lord went out in the temple of the Lord. And that's what we have today. The word of God has gone out. We're living in a time the Bible talks about in 2 Thessalonians, when it tells us, you know, we're living in that time when that great falling away come is happening. This is 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 3. I'm going to start at verse 3. He said, let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. In other words, the Antichrist. But it couldn't come until we're in the state we are now, when the word of God is absent. Like he said, when the word of the Lord had went out in the temple. That's where we're at now. Nobody seems to know what was the message of Christ. You know, evil is being called good and good is called evil. So you begin to present truth to the people, and they'll perceive you as backwards. If we were to tell you about homosexual marriages, homosexuals, and all of a sudden, now you're backwards. You don't understand. You know, you're old fashioned. Well, God had already let us know, and it is an abomination, people, that it's something that is leading to destruction of our society. The family, which is the nucleus of a nation, is disappearing. So we see there's a good, be a great falling away first. And so the word of God is absent in the churches. We see that. We see the results of it upon our society. Okay? And so what was the message, though, that was preached? You know, because we're looking at the collapsing of all these nations around us, and we're living in America. It was so funny. Everybody acts like America is never going to have a fall. Like, there's never going to be an end to all of this corruption that she has bred on the world, you know, what she has unleashed on the world. And looking at scriptures, we're going to Revelations. I want to go to Revelations 18. Because there was something told to us, and I noticed, you know, that there's a new phenomenon going on out there, and that's the Hebrew Israelite movement. All of a sudden, all these people realize they're the Hebrews, and they realize their ethnicity. And like I said, I have no problem with that, but at the same time, they feel like they're the only ones who're going to be saved because of their lineage, and that is not the case. You know, when a person takes a look at this word and begin to think it is a When you point out truths of the Bible, and they begin to look at it as a racial issue, because white supremacy has been the teaching of Christianity basically since 325. But not getting lost, let's deal with what's going on in our world, because we're trying to assimilate what we shouldn't be trying to assimilate. We should be doing as the Word of God has told us. And we start, we can start in verse 1, because this is a description. Many people say America is not in the Bible. That's not true. After these things, I saw an angel, and this is Revelations 18, in verse 1. After these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and has become the habitation of devils, America. Okay, in the hole of every foul spirit, in the cage of every unclean and hateful bird. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of fornication, for worldly lust. And the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her. And the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. And I heard another voice from heaven saying, Come out of her, my people, that you be not partakers of her sins, and that you receive not of her plagues. This is where we're at. People would argue the point that how do you figure America is Babylon the Great? And that is an easy show of who it is. They claim America's not there. They claim this Christianity that you guys see today, which is no more than Catholicism, is the actual truth, and it is not. And I'll show you why I say it's Catholicism. And why it's not the truth is not the same message that Christ was preaching. It was our teaching. Okay, and it's going to be, this real quick, I'm not going to read all of chapter 17, Revelation 17. Okay, and we can start at verse 12, because that's where we're at in world government. A lot of people don't understand Daniel, and I have books that you can look at the end of this video, because it's not going to be a very long video. You can look at the books and go get these books and be spiritually blessed. And one is The Revival of the Roman Empire, The Devil Workshop, and The Caliphate Rise of the Islamic Nation and Temple Mount. You find all of those at the end of this video, as well as at Amazon. Okay, and because this is what it's dealing with. It's dealing with the ending of our government system as we know it, where we're at today. And I'm going to show you how this America plays in. It says in this is chapter 17, verse 11. Okay, it says, and the beast that was and is not, he is of the eight and is of the seven, and going into perdition. And I'm gonna go back, people, because I'm jumping in, and this to show you this is a rise and fall of world government, because that was what Daniel was talking about in chapter 2, when he had the head of gold, the arms and chest of silver, and then the belly of brass, and then the two legs of iron, and then the 10 toes, that statue that the rock crashed into. And it was their government systems were filed no more. And I explained that in my book, The Revival of the Roman Empire. It says, and this is verse 9, and here is the mind which has wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sitteth, where she has control over. And there are seven kings, five are fallen, one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he comes, he must continue a short space. And the beast that was and is not, even he is of the eight and is of the seven, and goeth into perdition, into destruction. And the ten horns which thou saw are ten kings, which have received no kingdom as yet, but received power as kings 1 hour with the beast, the Antichrist. And they have one mind, and shall give their powers and strength unto the beast. And they shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them, for he is Lord of lords and kings of kings. People don't understand this. This is what I'm going to get into, the true message of Christ, the true gospel that we don't hear. And they that are with him are called, chosen, and faithful. Okay. And he says, and he said unto me, the waters which thou saw, where the whore city are people, multitudes, and nations, and tongues, the great melting pot, America. And the ten horns which thou saw upon the beast, they shall hate the whore, and shall make her desolated and naked, and shall eat her flesh and burn her with fire. That is the judgment that's going to overtake America eventually. And for God has put it in their heart, their minds, to fulfill his will, to agree, and to give their kingdom unto the beast, the Antichrist, that one more order that is coming, until the word of God shall be fulfilled. The woman which thou saw is that great city which reigned over the kings of the earth, the UN. And so we hearing, this is the UN. You look at these scriptures and you really look, because you talk about the five that are fallen, that became visible during World War II with the three groups that your allies and Axis powers you had. The first one to fall was Benito Mussolini. Then after that you had Nazi Germany. Then you had Hiroshima. Britain ceased to be a world power. Then you had number five with the Berlin Wall, when Russia ceased to be a world power. America six with the housing bubble, and the study, and it's been in the decline ever since. Number seven is your EU that is now present. And eight is the Arab Alliance, when that Mahdi, that Antichrist, come on the scene and is able to gather the Arab people in one group, in one voice, and they're going to join, make an alliance with the European Union. You have the Antichrist and all that involved. But so what we see in, as we go in, you know, just looking at this is really an issue when we start dealing with the world government. People look at church and not understanding that when you're dealing with church, that is an insert into the Bible. The word church itself has been inserted. People are like, what do you mean is an insert? I'm like, it is an insert, man. Regardless of how everybody feel about it, the word church initially, when the Bible was initially written, that word did not exist in our Bible. It was congregation or assembly. You were congregating or assembling as a nation. Okay, so they added that word around 325 during the time of Constantine, which totally distorts the picture of the gospel. It totally does what Satan was intending, and that was to cause the gospel to be hidden. I'm going to go back to that, but I want to show you something that people overlook when they sit up here trying to dismiss the Bible or badmouth the Bible. And it's something here that you need to recognize. Okay, and it says in the spirit, okay, it's in this verse 22, Revelations 22. I hope I haven't lost you, because I see myself jumping all over here. Revelations 22 and 17. And it said, in the spirit of the bride say, come. And let him that hear it say, come. And let him that is athirst come. And whosoever will, let him take the water of the life freely. For I testify to every man that heareth the words of the prophecy of this book. If any man added to these things, so it's telling you this, they can be added. Something can be added in here that should not be in here. And right now what I'm dealing with is the word church. It says, and God shall add unto him the plagues that are written in this book. And if any man shall take away from the words of this book, a book of this prophecy, God shall take away his part out of the book of life and out of the holy city. For these things which are written is it for which are written in this book. So some things can be added and some things can be subtracted. Does it mean the Bible's bad? No, because if you follow his process and procedure, you'll see through what is added. So for instance, the word church doesn't fit the message of Christ, because his very first message of Christ is what? I'm going to Matthew's, because I want to look Matthew's 4. I want to show you the opening message of Christ and why I was able to look at and see the word church. And then looking at everything the Bible is talking about is about rise and fall of world government. What is Christ offering us? He's offering us eternal life in a better place to live, with a better government system that is governed by God. Not something that's governed by man and is always in some kind of chaos or turmoil, where we live in peace and harmony with one another, where there is no racism or hatred for your fellow man, where you don't listen to a president who's just full of hating and not even a moral character to even be in that kind of office, bringing a woman in office who clearly talked about the people before them because of their ethnicity, their color. Talk about the woman Michelle Obama, when he brings a woman who clearly was prostituting herself or posing nude. No moral character. When good should be called evil and evil called good. Those people are not moral people. And so here he is, and this is Christ's first message. Okay, this is after he had been tempted by the devil. This is the very first thing he says. And this is chapter 4, verse 17. And Christ comes in Matthew chapter 4, in verse 17. So before the time Jesus began to preach, in other words, to teach, and to say, repent, for what? The kingdom of heaven is at hand. It was present. It was near to come. He was here. He was the king. And he was here for the purpose of bringing about this kingdom. And he is the king. He was born for the very purpose of being of actually being the king over the nations. And you see the gospel that we don't hear. This is what the church and these so-called preachers who have never been sent by God. And I'm going to step on Jeremiah 23. I want to show you something. And this is the part of the problem. A lot of these guys out there have never been born again. They have no parts of the kingdom of God, but yet they have a word for you. What word could that possibly be? I have followed process and procedure according to scriptures, not according to my will or my purpose. Here it is, and it's going to be Jeremiah 23, verses 21 and 22. Listen to what he said. He says, I have not sent these prophets, yet they run. They're out there. I have not spoken to them, yet they prophesied. He ain't made no scripture revelations to them, but yet they have a word. That's like I hear these guys with this Hebrew Israelite, and it's true. We know Jesus couldn't be white because simple fact that he was sent down into Egypt where he tells him to get up and take the child when Jesus was first born, the virgin birth of Mary, take the child and go down into Egypt. And you know, colonization has taken effect over that, you know, to lighten up the people. But those people, when you see the true Egyptians, you know, they were black people or people of dark skin color. So you know, if he was sent down to Egypt, he would have to be of that same nature, because he could not hide. If he was white, he was stuck out like a sore thumb. And we know Egypt in Africa. So we sent him down to Egypt, then he called him out of Egypt. So we know that. That goes without saying. But then there's a group that feel, because of their ethnicity, they're going to be saved. But the Bible does not teach that. There's people out there teaching these people. I've seen Louis Farrakhan recently show Elijah Muhammad as if he was Jesus, which we know is a lie too. So they out here trying to teach, but he has not sent them. They have not spoken. He has not spoken to them, because if he had spoken to them, the way God speaks is scriptural revelation. If there's no scriptural revelation in what you're talking about, you can't bring the scripture clearly. Then truly, you're not from God. He said, but if they had stood in my counsel, in his word, and have caused my people to hear, in other words, hear not just the audible sound, but understand my word, then should they turn them from their evil ways and the evil of their doing, which is contrary to God. Okay, so we find out the very first message of Jesus, you know, they're not telling them this because they don't know this, because they're not a part. And it clearly states, his very opening message was for, said, from that time Jesus began to teach after he had been tested by Satan. He proved that he was loyal to God and he wasn't going to backtrack. And he said, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. The kingdom of heaven. This is his message. It was the kingdom. He wasn't talking nothing else. And even when he was being questioned by Pilate, look what he said. Pilate recognized who he was, and Pilate was pretty much telling him, your nation. And so what is this we hearing today when we go to church? And it operates just like the word, because you deal with the word ecclesia, and that's called out once, called out to be a part of his kingdom. And you deal with the word church, the ecclesia cannot be translated in church. You have to substitute that word with the word kakusta, that word means Lord or ruler house. And when you go to church, what do you see? It runs just like what is the name, Lord or ruler house. And that was done in 325 because of Constantine losing control over his kingdom. They were fighting over the Trinitarian doctrine at that time. And so to get a hold of these people, they established what was the church that comes from Catholicism. Now listen, this is John chapter 18, verse 33. And Pilate entered into the judgment hall again and called Jesus and said unto him, art thou the king? Notice, the king of the Jews. Yes, he's the Savior, but he is the king and priest after the order of Melchizedek. Jesus answered him, saying, this thing, he says, say thou this thing of thyself? Did you come up with this? Or did others tell thee of me? Or did somebody else tell you this about me? Pilate answered and answered, am I a Jew? No, am I part of your people? I said, am I a Jew? Thy own nation and chief priests have delivered thee unto me. What hast thou done? Okay, and Jesus answered, my kingdom is not of this world. It is my king. He said, my kingdom were of this world. In other words, this present system. Then would my servants fight that I should not be delivered to the Jews. But now is my kingdom not far from here. It wasn't far to come, because the kingdom came in two parts. A lot of people don't know that. This is the real gospel. He was talking about establishing his kingdom that was going to supersede all of these other kingdoms. That is what the vision in Daniel was about in chapter 2, when that rock that was not cut out without hand came and hit that statue. It was symbolic of all of the world governments, and it swept them all away. And that rock became a great mountain. He became that one, that true one world order, which we got the Antichrist here to come and mimic him right now. But he was talking about a kingdom. This is what's not taught in the church. People go to church, really, to me, the worst day time, because all their guys are doing is hustling. You know, there's nothing wrong with blessing somebody if they give you something spiritual. But at the same time, they're just hustling. They're not teaching you what the real word was. They're not teaching you that at this time, we need to be aware of what's going on right now. We're entering in a time that's called Jacob Trouble, but not just that. This world government system is ending. We got the new world order, the globalist coming first before Christ will bring in his kingdom, which is going to supersede them, and he's going to be the real new world order, not this counterfeit one world order before his actual order comes. Okay, and this is chapter Luke 17 in verse 20. It said, when he was demanded of the Pharisees when the kingdom of God shall come. Look what they're looking for. They're looking for a kingdom. What are you looking for? You go to church, you're looking for what kind of blessings? In the here and now? That's all they're talking about, hearing now. When the real church, or not church, but when they really came together or assembled as a nation, or congregated as a nation, they were learning how they have the right mindset to enter into the kingdom of God. When that physical presence came, okay, before that can come, the spiritual kingdom had to come. Okay, and it says, and he said unto the disciples, the day will come when you shall say, wait a minute, I skipped, I'm sorry, y'all. Verse, back to verse 20. And when he had, was demanding of the Pharisees, when the kingdom of God shall come, he answered them and said, the kingdom of God come not with observance. You ain't gonna know, it's not coming with observance. Neither shall I say, lo here, or lo there, for behold, the kingdom of God is within you. It's gonna be within you. When you see the first birth of the kingdom of God come. And I'm gonna stop by Acts 1 first, and then I'm going on to Acts 2. And this is the problem today. See, I've been born again. I followed the process and procedure of what he was talking about. Verse 6, 1 and 6. He said, when therefore was come, they come together, they asked of him, saying, Lord, will thou at this time restore again the kingdom of Israel? Will he give them royal dominance again at that time? And he said unto them, it is not for you to know the times or the season which the Father has put in his own power. But ye shall receive power after what? The Holy Ghost has come upon you. Not before, but after. After they have been born again. After the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem, and in Judea, and Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the earth. But after, they have no power, they have no authority, because he has not commissioned these people. But they're out there teaching. See, I followed this process of procedure. And it's like it was saying in the Gospel of John, except a man be born again, become a recreative creature, he cannot see the kingdom of God. That is John 3 and 3. And then it goes on to say in John, the same Gospel of John 3 and 5, chapter 3, verse 5, it says, except a man is born of water and spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. They're not telling you that. They're not telling you that these things are requirements. Now let's look at the day, the first birth of the kingdom of God. When that part comes in, we're looking at, he says, then seasons, he has an S on that. So the spiritual birth was to take birth place first, and then now we wait in his physical arrival to bring Elisha in his kingdom. But right now, all those people, still, it's still time for you to be baptized in Jesus' name and do what you're supposed to do and submitting to the scriptures, and he will. He gives the spirit to those that obey him and accept you into his kingdom. That's proof that you're accepted. Okay, let's look at what Luke was saying. He said it comes without observance. The kingdom of God was coming out of observance. When the day of Pentecost, and this is Acts 2, one, when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound, you know, without observance. Certainly there came a sound from heaven, as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them, filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as a fire, and it set upon each of them. And they were all filled with what? The Holy Ghost. And begin to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now this is a big controversy. The people look at this meaning thinking you're supposed to speak in a babbling tongue. Just keep reading. Don't get deceived on that. That means ability. Utterance. Ability. It's put in there, but it's ability. And they were all dwelling at Jerusalem, devout men out of every nation under heaven. Now when this was noise abroad, the multitude came together and were confounded, because that every man heard them speaking in his own language. Where is your babbling tongue? That is witchcraft, according to Isaiah 8. And I'll go there before I finish this. Okay. And they were all amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galilean? And said, how hear we every man in our own tongue wherein we were born? There was no ecstatic tongue on that day. They understood what was being said. Verse 21 in Acts 2, and it said, it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved, shall be delivered. Now how that, that's content, that is not application. How do you apply that? Just hold on and you'll see. It said, ye men of Israel, hear these words, Jesus of Nazareth, a man. Where you get it, God? Where's he got it? A man approved of God among you by miracles and wonders and signs which God did by him in the midst of you, as ye yourselves also know. So where you get that he is God? That's a Trinitarian doctrine that teaches that Jesus God. The Bible don't teach that. They teach he was a man, a creation of God, his son. Okay? It said, now notice this. They heard, he told them about calling up on the name of the Lord. So they looked for clarification. Those who were standing there. Therefore, let all the house of Israel know surely that God has made the same Jesus whom you have crucified, both Lord, supreme authority, and Christ, our Holy Ghost. And now when they heard this, they were pricked. They were convicted in their hearts and their minds and said, in other words, because they understood what was being told to them. It wasn't something foreign. The word of God had been made plain. Conviction came upon them. And said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Didn't he just tell them, calling up on the name of the Lord, you should be saved? Then he gave them a way to apply that to their life, application, not just content. Context, okay? Verse 38 says, then Peter said unto them, repent, and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for what? For the remission of sins, really the applying of God, of Jesus' blood, not God, but the Son of God's blood, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost, for the promises unto you, to your children, and to all that are far off, even as many as our Lord our God shall call. If you're called, you're going to follow this. If you're not called, you're not going to follow this. But he told you to be baptized in Jesus' name, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of sins. And I know I made a statement that that's how the applying of the blood, how you apply the blood. Let's look at Revelations 1 and 5. And Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth. Listen, he's the prince of the kings of the earth. He is a king. You guys miss who he really is, what he really come for. He came to deliver those who's going to be a part of his coming kingdom. Unto him that loved us and washed us from our what? Sins in his own blood. So the blood, that blood is applied to you when you're baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Other than that, the blood is not on you. You can come with whatever falsehood you confess, and Lord save you, you're a liar. If you ain't been baptized in Jesus' name and filled with his Holy Ghost, you are not a part of that. And so many people are deceived, have been deceived into believing they are part of this, and they're not. Acts 19. So you say you believe, and some of you sit up there wondering, what are you talking about? I like, okay. This is something that's not being taught in the churches today, in the Lord's ruler house. Acts 19. Okay, and it came to pass, while Apollos was at Corinth, Paul, having passed through the upper coasts, came to Ephesus and finding certain disciples. And he said unto them, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? What is your confirmation? Have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? How do you know you're part of the kingdom of God? How do you know you're saved? Just because you believe it? What's your proof? Where is your proof? And he said, he asked, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? And they said unto him, we not so much as heard whether there be any Holy Ghost. They're not telling you that if you're not born of water and spirit, in other words, if you don't have the Holy Ghost, you ain't been baptized in Jesus' name, you ain't going to enter into the kingdom of God. And that physical kingdom is coming. But there's a spiritual kingdom too you got to be born in first. And this is proof that you have been accepted. I remember when I got baptized in Jesus' name. I remember when I was standing in the pew and not being taken to no room to get some ecstatic tongue or fall off into some trance of witchcraft being put up on me. I was standing in the pew, and I just said, thank you, Jesus. I magnify his name according to chapter Isaiah 12. Well, in water, I was in joy. I was glad. It was an inner joy. I remember feeling humble because I never once spoke in no foreign tongue. I said, thank you, Jesus. Something you understand. It was Jesus in me that day. And they go on to say, verse 3, and he said to them, unto what then were you baptized? How was you baptized? And they said, unto John baptism. And then said Paul, John verily baptized with the baptism of repentance, saying unto them that they should believe on him which should come after him, that is on Christ Jesus. And when they heard this, when they understood what he was saying, they were baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. And they were, and look at this, it says, and when Paul had laid his hand on them, the Holy Ghost came upon them, they were accepted into the kingdom. And they spake with tongues and prophesied. We're just speaking with tongues, and there was no understanding of what you said. Talking about you praying to God. In what world? In what world, people? And I'm finna finish out here. And I actually hope you guys have heard me. Because all of this stopped, and this was taught to us by the disciples as the Bible ascribed. I'm going to Isaiah 8 and 16. Tell you what they're doing. Isaiah 16. So at the end of the video, look at my books, go out there and get them. It'll be a spiritual blessing, not so much monetary, but a spiritual blessing to help you know what you need to do in these times that you're living and where you're at in time. So bind up the testimony, instill the law among my disciples. See, he said he bound it up, it was finished at the disciples. And it says, seal the law among my disciples. So anything coming after them ain't nothing to be messed with. He said, I will wait up on the Lord that hide his face from the house of Jacob, and I will look for him. And behold, I and the children whom the Lord hath given me are for signs and wonders in Israel. What did you see after the day of Pentecost? They begin to do all these signs and wonders. Now you got these guys outside of Israel with all these fake witchcraft stuff they got going on, telling people they healing people and all that. But he said for wonders. See, the Bible's a great thing. It lets you know where this was to take place at. So you won't be out here with this foolishness talking about you healing people. It said they were signed for signs and wonders in Israel, for the Lord of hosts was dwelling in Mount Zion. It said, and when they shall say unto you, seek unto them that have a familiar spirit, unto wizards that peep and that mutter, there is your ecstatic tongue. Wizard, familiar spirits, that's all you're getting on you. And should not a people seek unto their God for the living to the dead? Is it to the law, which is the Old Testament, and to the testimony of the New Testament, that they speak not according to this word, is because there is no light in them. There is no knowledge of God in them. And I hope you guys enjoyed this. Like I said, subscribe to A Revolutionary Connection with Joseph Smith. And my other group on Facebook is Road to Armageddon. And subscribe to those groups. And I try to keep positive things posted and stay in the Word of God. I'm not going to tell you something that's not in there. You can go back and look at everything I'm doing. Play this video over and over. Pull all the scripture out of it and go look and see if what I'm saying is true or false. We're living in an era where the Word of God is precious. Like he said, there should be a famine in the land. And then like in the time we're living, just like in the time of Samuel, the Word of God was precious. You know, there's not too many people with real scriptural understanding and scriptural knowledge. They give you an interpretation, your opinion, without a revelation. I can show you scripture for scripture, what I believe. And get my books, which will be at the end of the thing. Get them on Amazon. Y'all have a great night.